Hi folks, and thanks for joining us for another one of these pop-up webinars brought to you by Astute Graphics. My name is Sebastian Bleak, and in a little bit we're going to be joined by Astute Graphics founder, Nicholas Vanderwall. All right, so here I am. I'm going to get started in this blank document. I'm going to go over some of our halftone features and how to use those guys. So lately we've been doing a lot of workflow stuff, tips and tricks, but this time we're just going to target on this specific function for the halftone. All right, so here I got a blank document. If you don't want to see the pasteboard at all, just hit Command-Shift-H, and now you just have a clean whiteboard. All right, so I want to lay out some artwork here, so that way Phantasm has something to play with. I'll come over here to Tools Panel, activate my Dynamic Shapes tool, and while I have the mouse clicked down, I'm going to hit the number 2, and that's going to switch over to a dynamic circle for me. All right, so I'll just drop this guy off right here, and make sure I got a nice black circle here. All right, before I go into Phantasm, I'm actually going to blur this guy up a bit. That way we have something to play around with the halftoning. So over here, I'm going to activate my stylism tool and then just drop in this Gaussian blur effect. I'm going to up the radius, and then I get this warning. I could go into this in more detail during the question and answer if you'd like, but basically just to get rid of this, click OK. And if you don't want to see it anymore, just check this box. I'll click OK, and that allows me to have this effect here. I got a good blend going on, so I could hide the stylism panel. All right, so in order to activate your Phantasm halftone effect, you have to come over here to the effect menu, and then at the bottom, you're going to find Phantasm. Over here, you have all these different functions that Phantasm has, but this is one we're going to target on, the halftone. So when I click on that, it brings up the Phantasm halftone panel. And here, you have all these different options, and right away, this DPI section is highlighted. You see it's even framed up with this little orange piece. So I could come in here and just change the resolution straight away. When I hit tab, you see it's already been updated. So I dropped the resolution to 3 so I could get these really big circles going on here. All right, so let's take a look at this section right here at the top. All right, right now I have this set to a monochrome type, but you could change it to RGB or sampled. The RGB is going to give you the original color in your artwork. But right now, since I have it black, let's change it to a different color. I could choose my favorite color, which is orange, but to make sure that I got some good contrast on the screen for you guys, I'm going to choose a dark red to make sure it shows up good here. All right, cool. So we already have a really cool looking halftone effect here. What I like about it is that we're seeing a preview. So this is something we don't get native in Adobe Illustrator. I could actually see what my halftoning is like right here before I get out of this panel. So over here, I want to make some changes to it. In this section, you have different patterns that you could use. And then once you choose a pattern, you could go into this drop-down menu right here and change its behavior a bit. So right now we're using this grid pattern, and I could change it to alternating, which gives me this really cool effect here. We have this FM option. I also like this radial one down here. Right now it's set to 5 spoke, but you could change it to 6. And while I have this guy highlighted, I could hit the down arrow key to cycle through the different variations. So this looks pretty cool, but I'm actually going to leave it back on the grid. And I liked how it looked with the alternating. All right, that's cool. Now, another thing you could change on here to make it look a little different is right here in the grid angle. Now, I could click right here and I have this little slider. I could bring in a negative value if I go towards the left or a positive value if I go towards the right. Again, sometimes I like just highlighting this value and then just using the up or down arrow keys to cycle through them until I get an effect that I like. So I'm holding down the shift key and it's jumping up in increments of 10. But if I just use the arrow keys alone, you see it's cycling through one digit at a time and I get this really cool look here. Once I get a look I like, I'll release it and continue on that way. All right, so right here we have an option of adding an undercoat. So let me check this. I really don't need it for this exercise, but I'm gonna bring it up just so you can see what's going on. I'll give a little green undercoat. And when I choose OK, you can see it's updated right here to have this green undercoating right here. I'll get rid of that for now. And next we have the origin of this. So by default, it's set to relative to selection. So right now it's actually coming from the center. As you see, it's right here, the origin point is set to center. So it's kind of just radiating from here on out. You could switch it to artboard. So now it's using the center of the artboard because I have this guy checked here. And that's what it's using to create these. But I'll leave it set to selection. And check this out. If you want to change the origin point within the selection, just click right here. And now it's coming from the upper left. I'll leave it on the center. And right here, you could even offset it. So I'm going to hold down the shift key and the up arrow key. And you see it's moving about. I'll leave it set to 0 pixels. But I just wanted to show you that you have that option right here. All right, so this whole section was pretty much how we were going to lay out our dots, what color they were going to be. And down here, this is going to be the dot property. So we could actually change the actual shapes themselves. All right, so in here, we have this shape option. It's set to circle by default. When I click on it, I get this drop-down menu. The next option is going to be square. So I'll choose that one, and look, we got some cool squares here. I hit the down arrow key, and now I have these lines. They end up looking a little bit like a pill shape here. I'll go down to the next one and have this really cool option of having character shapes. So I got really excited when I first saw this. This is awesome. So I'll come over here and I'll click on options. And now I have the halftone character options. In here, you could choose a different font. I'm going to leave it at Myriad Pro. It looks pretty clean. And when I have this button checked here, it's showing that it's going to just pick random characters. Now I'm going to choose this guy down here, and it's going to repeat whatever text I have going along in here. Right here we have the alphabet, so let me just get rid of this and hit the caps lock, and then let's see if Carlos is in the house today. I'll click OK, and you see it's updated over here. Now I have Carlos coming along here. Now, when I first played around with this feature, I thought I was pretty much done. I couldn't really move these guys around, but look, you have the option of scaling these guys. I can make these guys bigger and get a little stylized effect going on here. Now, it's doing it in proportion for me right here. It upped this one over here to 160. If I click on this chain here, it'll actually break the relation between them, and I could change these values individually. Now, we also have this grid angle up here, so if you want to move around these letters, you could definitely do that there. So I'll continue on this way. Right here, you have the tint adjustments. It's set by default for width and height, and that's why you see the scaling going on right here proportionally. But again, we give you more options. So right here, you could do it only by height, and see it's only affecting the height at the moment. And with the up arrow key, it's only affecting the width. And one more option, just none. So there is no scaling going on here. This looks pretty cool too. It's creating an awesome little pattern with all these letters. And I could come back in here and change those letters if I'd like later. All right, so last over here, well, not last, but we have this angle section right here. It's set to zero at the moment. When I click this guy, you get another little slider. We could enter in a negative value. Or if we go towards the right, we could enter in a positive value. I like, as I've been saying, I like highlighting this guy and just using my up and down arrow keys to cycle through these until I get a look that I like. All right, this blend is set to normal, but we also have the option of creating a little bit of a transparency there. I'll leave it at normal. Right here, we have this graph. We can start making some more changes here. Let me actually bring this to width and height. There you go. And now you can see, let me get rid of this one so you can see what's going on. Here we go. All right, so I'll get rid of these 2 points, and this is how it is normally. And then I'll click and drag, and you see it's starting to give me different variations here. Now it's using this graph to figure out how it's going to size these letters out for me. Okay, so the only shape that I haven't covered so far is this last one right here, selected symbol. Now, this is kind of like the main reason why I wanted to cover this topic, is we never really go too deep into the selected symbol option. When I click on it, everything goes away. So the first time I used this option, I thought I was doing something wrong or it didn't work correctly. Excuse me. But it's actually, I just didn't know what I was doing. So I'm going to hit cancel to get out of this because there's a little bit of setup involved here. What I have to do is actually create a symbol first. So I'm going to enlist the help of my dynamic sketch tool and my tablet. So let me bring this panel up for dynamic sketch. I don't need the gesture trimming on. This looks good. All right, so I'm just going to draw out a little character here to create for my symbol. So I got this guy here. And look, it's still using the appearance of my previous artwork here. So just hit D to get your basic appearance. And let's see. I actually want to set this guy to stylus pressure. So I get a little bit of thickness going on here. And let's see what this looks like. I'll click and drag. And I see I got a fill going on here, so I'll get rid of that. And I want to do a little bit more setup with my stroke. I want to make sure I have these nice round edges here. All right, that looks good. And I'll bring this guy in this way. And there we go. So when I deselect it, you see I have this little orange. Well, he's going to be orange character now. Come over here. There we go. That looks better. Got this little orange nerd here. And I could use this guy as a symbol now. So let me just make sure I got them all selected. And to bring up your symbols panel, just come over here to the window menu. Come on down until you find symbols. And when you click on it, it'll pop up. All right, so all I have to do is click and drag into this panel. And when I release, I get the symbol options. Now I can name it. So nerd, I hit tab, and then I'll change it from movie clip to graphic, and then just hit enter or return on your keyboard, and you're set. All right, so I'm already done with this guy, so I don't need that anymore. And you want to make sure you have this guy selected. So let me show you what I'm talking about here. You see these other symbols, they don't have this little black frame around them. If I click in the panel, it's actually deselecting that symbol for me. So before we go into Phantasm, you want to click on the symbol that you want to use to make sure it's actually selected. All right, so I got that guy going there. I'll select my artwork, come over to Effect, Phantasm, and then find Halftone. All right, so now we got this halftone up. I'm going to drop the resolution so we get these nice big dots and change the shape to selected symbol. All right, cool. Now I got all these little nerds right here. And remember, we can make all kind of changes here. So I'm going to scale this guy up a bit. All right, around there looks good. Let's change this. I'll leave it at grid, maybe alternating. And then remember, change the grid angle. Shift up arrow key starts giving me some dramatic changes. If I just use the arrow keys alone, you see I'm doing incremental changes and I could decide what look I'm going for. All right, that looks like a pretty good pattern, but I want to spin these guys around a little bit. So I'll come over here to this angle and I'll make some changes along here. That looks good. And I'm pretty much done here, but I'm actually going to hit cancel and show you one more use with the symbol thing. So I'll pick up my tablet again, activate dynamic sketch. And this time I want to set it to want to have this gesture trimming feature going on here. So all I'm going to do is create a little organic shape here. Now, again, it's using the appearance from my previous artwork. So I'll hit the D key and that'll give me this basic appearance of a white fill with a black stroke. All right. So I got this guy going on here and I just created like a little rip. I wasn't really going for anything in particular, but I just wanted to create like this little tear. Now, I'll bring up the, I hit the V key to get my selection tool. Drag and drop this guy over here into the symbols. I'll name this guy Rip, down, enter. And then I could get rid of this guy. All right, cool. So I'll select my artwork, make sure that my symbol is targeted, effect, and then come down here to Phantasm Halftone. All right, I'll drop the resolution and then come over here to the shape, change the shape to a selected symbol. And now we have this torn piece here. So again, you can start playing around with these to get different looks. I'll up this guy. Let's change this to radial, seven spoke. I'm just doing random maneuvers here to get different looks. Here we go, we'll spin these guys around and change this grid angle a little bit, maybe to 30 or so, see what happens. And there you go. So I end up using this type of effect to, you know, for colorizing things, giving rough edges, creating some sort of texture in my pieces in Adobe Illustrator. The last thing I want to show you is if you accept that, come over into your appearance panel, excuse me, which you can find over here in the Windows, find appearance. And right in here, you see we have this Phantasm halftone effect. So these are live effects. You could click on it and you come back here, make whatever change you wish. And then when you click OK, it's already updated. Well, there you go, folks. That's the end of our demo today for our pop-up webinar. For those of you guys that got to take off, we really appreciate your time. Come check us out again next time. And for those of you guys that can stick around, get your questions ready because we're about to get joined by Nicholas Vanderwall over in the Astute Graphics headquarters.